walking to work can be a daily routine. But when your work is in the middle of the North Sea, there's a lot of technology needed for a safe walk. To produce gas in the southern part of the North Sea in a safer and more efficient manner, NUM and Shell UK have combined their forces into a close cooperation called One Gas.
Between the two companies, we decided that in the southern North Sea, it doesn't make any sense to actually not work together.
Together, they're responsible for 9 manned and 47 normally unmanned installations.
In the past, there would maybe be supply boats sailing to the border and back to Den Helder, and also boats from the other side that would get very close to each other, and then they would all both turn back. So now we have boats going across the border, we have helicopters flying across, and we just operate it as it's one.
The way gas fields operate has changed in the last 40 years. Older gas fields have become more or less exhausted, and new offshore installations have become smaller and more flexible. Nowadays, the maintenance crews of One Gas fly by helicopter or use a chartered vessel to reach the unmanned platforms. The current way of working with helicopters is safe but inefficient and has lots of limitations, such as the relatively high costs, while productive hours are limited. A totally different logistics solution was invented, an autonomous vessel to maintain all offshore installations independent of helicopters or other vessels. With this idea of a custom-built maintenance vessel, the market was approached. The Walk to Work project was born and is changing the entire offshore industry. On Thursday, July 11th, 2013, NUM and ship owner Royal Wagenborg from Delfzijl signed a cooperation agreement. NUM and Shell UK selected Royal Wagenborg to support her offshore operations for the upcoming 10 years.
Wagenborg is the, let's say, the operator for a 10 years contract. Next to that, we have also a contract between Wagenborg Offshore and Kroonborg Niestern Sander.
Royal Niestern Sander will build the so-called walk-to-work vessel for Royal Wagenborg on a very tight schedule. Setting the delivery deadline at February 2015, while the key innovative functions still had to be developed, makes this project quite a challenge.
In the last year, we did basically the main design of the vessel, together with the NUM and together with Wagenborg. And from week 48, we start with the actual steelwork on the shipyard.
It's no surprise that two companies from the north of the Netherlands are involved. In this relatively small region, you'll find one of the world's most innovative shipbuilding and maritime industries.
About a year ago, the NUM came with a functional specification. And they invited a number of parties to come up with the design, shipyards and ship designers. And they selected our design to be the winning design.
Safety and high levels of comfort were two of the main requirements in the design. Royal Niestern Sander, in cooperation with ship designer Kono Ship, distinguished itself from the competition with their extreme focus on the hull design and stability.
In contrary to what a lot of people think, we're not focusing on getting the highest possible stability, but in fact it's more finding the lowest possible stability in combination with meeting all the regulations regarding intact stability and damp stability. Of course, we had a lot of belief in our calculations, but to show to the customer and to the client and to the operator that the ship is actually meeting its capabilities, we did a lot of seakeeping tests at Marin, and already in the test it was clear that there was almost no rolling of the ship.
The boundary conditions is that the vessel should be able to go to any location in the southern North Sea, whether it's UK or NL, and execute work. Yep. So we'll need to have the competencies and the experience available on board to isolate, de-isolate, start up, intervene, troubleshoot, whatever.
That approach of operating and maintaining the offshore installations is pretty new. That is not very common worldwide, and that requires this new type of vessel.
The walk-to-work vessel combines transportation, accommodation, workshop and storage facilities for 60 people in one single design.
Two-thirds of the functionality of the vessel is conceptual. It hasn't never been integrated before in one vessel.
It is not just a replacement of one vessel or other vessels. It's a brand new game.
Equipped with innovative motion-compensated elements such as a gangway and crane, the vessel is designed to be operational 300 days a year.
We use all the practical information from Wagenborg. They know about crews and their special needs. They know about offshore and the special requirements.
And I think together with the NAM guys and Shell UK guys, we are really a team. And I think we fit to each other because we have the same attitude. Not looking to what is difficult, but finding out how we can solve the difficulties.
With the NAM headquarters located in the center of the Northern Netherlands and Royal Wagenborg and Niestern Sander at the coast, the walk-to-work project will be of great regional importance. On November 18, 2013, the building starts with a small ceremony for such a complex project. Detailed plans are required before construction can be started. This particular plan was created using a software tool developed in the north of the Netherlands and actively used in 41 countries around the world.
We are working in a 3D model in a program called New Pass Schematic. Every subcontractor and Niestern Sander has an own part in it.
So we share, and we share things in a 3D model, and it makes us a powerful cooperation.
Cooperation is the key word in the Walk to Work project. The project is based on the idea of sharing information.
More and more information is connected to the 3D model. So when you click, for example, a pipe, you get immediately the production information to produce that pipe. That is, of course, handy while you are producing the ship, but also if you want to replace that after, let's say, 10 years of service.
Many of the companies involved in the Walk to Work project make use of this 3D model in parallel with one another. This has a tremendously positive impact on accuracy and costs.
A good example is Voith Vessels, who recently invested in this CNC pipe bending machine. Well, that machine has also the ability to use the data directly from our software. It reduces the amount of man hours, of course, but it also increases the precision and it decreases the chances of failures.
Voith Vessels fills almost 50% of the 3D model with their systems, installations and piping. The 3D model is coming to life. Since many functions on the walk-to-work vessel are brand new, data such as the chemical storage tanks, cold startup installation, and motion-compensated crane are not included in the 3D model. Nevertheless, with an extremely tight deadline, Niestern Sander decided to start building so as to safeguard the ambitious schedule. Keeping one eye on the big picture and the other one on the details, it's evident that there are a lot of issues to be resolved by the project management team.
Our position is quite clear. We're not going to pay for anything else. We've agreed the full scope.
For Wagenborg's new building department and the yard, it's really a logistical project of tracking and managing all the information and material. There are thousands of components needed, and each one is unique. The only common elements are the welding wires that hold it together.
We hebben gewoon een soort teamgevoel. Iedereen die eraan meewerkt draagt gewoon een belangrijk stukje bij, draagt een steentje bij aan zeg maar het uiteindelijke doel. Dus ik heb, deze is in de Niestern Sander kleuren. Ik heb ook een beperkt aantal, die zijn eigenlijk in de Wagenborg kleuren, rood-wit.
Piece by piece, section after section, the vessel is not only built with people's hands, but also with their passion. Constructing such an ambitious vessel has involved hundreds of workers. It can be done, but only when they do it together. Once the blocks are ready, they can be transported to the quayside. This is another speciality of Royal Wagenborg. Wagenborg offers a complete service for hoisting, heavy transport and assembly. The section blocks are placed on tens of kegs. The quayside is strengthened for heavy payloads. After dismantling the huge construction scaffolding, the face of the newborn lady will be revealed. Heavy transport is precision work, especially when you're dealing with constructions that weigh many tons. After combining the two ring sections with mainly cabins and offices for marine crews, new challenges come to the surface.
Well, the most important thing is the dangerous cargo. The cargo we are intend to carry with the ship is never been carried underneath the deck before by any other project. So it's as well a challenge for us as for the regulation authorities. So we had to cooperate with them very closely to reach the satisfaction from both sides, to be sure that we are doing it the most safe way that we definitely want for your client.
NUM and Shell UK's platforms depend on production chemicals such as antifreeze and anti-rust to protect the thousands of kilometers of pipelines. Transporting the chemicals on the same vessel where 60 people are living requires extreme safety precautions.
We have faced a lot of changes. So we thought we will do it that way, but then you come across some rules or regulations which they know, but it should be the other way.
We've actually managing the engineering parallel to the building process, because when we signed the contract, I mean, we still didn't have the details on the cold startup unit. We didn't have the details on the crane. We yet had to select a manufacturer for the crane.
After months of delay, the production process of the main board and desk can finally start.
It's frustrating for everybody when things have to change. But because we are working with parties for a really long time, we have built a very good relationship with them. They understand that we have to do it together. Changes are made and we just have to face them. Nobody has another choice to just put hands together and do it.
I think it's more or less standard with a shipbuilding. It's always the case that you build the ship together. It's very important that the people understand each other and they respect each other.
It's a true co-makership, which means you are really looking not only over the shoulder of the owner, but you really need to want to get grasp on the details and to make sure we together we build the best possible vessel.
I think we have, in fact, two big production facilities. We have our switchboard and panel building facility directly here in Kolham. And of course, the most important production facility is in fact on the shipyard, because there The most of the hours are spent on in pulling the cables, connecting the switchboards, commissioning, etc., etc.
During familiarization days, NAM and Shell UK's crew learn more about the future mode of operation and Royal Wagenborg.
A family-owned company, existing 115 years. And we hate the word impossible. Of course, there are difficulties to overcome to reach a goal, but we are keen on looking for solutions where others maybe already think, well, this is too tough or too difficult.
Well, someone who hates the word impossible apparently knows that in the end everything is possible. That means that Wagenborg as a client is a very demanding one. They have a client who are also demanding, and that of course has his impact on the quality of the product we have to produce.
I don't think we realize yet how significant this is. You will see, I believe, that we will be starting a trend here in completely changing the way which we're operating and maintaining and operating our platforms.
Everybody wants to do something and wanted to optimize their flow.
Yep.
But then, of course, it never came together at the right time. Right. So we said, you know, we make something.
We are still planning. We are already planning right now for next year. When is the vessel where, in which of the four work areas?
Everyone involved in operating this innovative vessel needs to work in a different way, for which training days are organized. The crew can only be integrated if everyone experiences this training program together.
So what we did is to build the simulation around the team, the maintenance team, and what we call the management on shore, to get that cooperation good.
And then also add some dilemmas. What if we are executing planned maintenance work and a maintenance intervention is required from the staff on the boat? How are we going to do that?
This custom-made program was used to simulate the operations and communication between NAM, Shell UK, Wagenborg, AJS, a one-gas integrated service contractor, and Peterson as the Den Helder Port Authority. Knowing each other's roles and responsibilities, trusting and relying on each other is vital.
Okay, yeah.
And east.
So we can speak with job well done.
Job done, yeah.
Okay.
We crashed already. What do you do?
Check on the side.
Check the exits.
Training is important because you have to be prepared for emergency situations. For example, the helicopter crash, if you don't have any idea what to do when you crash into the sea in heavy weather conditions, and I think it'll cost your life.
All offshore workers will take and pass the basic offshore safety induction and emergency training. While training and simulations are the key to success, you can never be over-prepared. So, as shipping traditions dictate, a good luck coin is placed on a keg underneath the 2 million kilograms of steel.
Thank you all.
Now that all the ring sections are combined on the quayside, the Voith Schneider propulsion system will be installed over a 10-day period. An ingenious system for precise maneuvering and excellent station capabilities, even under extreme weather conditions. In shipbuilding, not everything is high-tech. Shipbuilding is steeped in tradition. The preparations of the vessel are prescribed. With millimeter accuracy, the 20 sledges are placed under the vessel. But there's still a part missing.
Yeah, that's a bit disappointing. I mean, there's two big gaping holes. Those are the designated places for the bow thrusters, which obviously will give the vessel its dynamic positioning capability. The manufacturer discovered some design issues. They had to rectify the design. So unfortunately, She's going to go into the water without the bow thruster, so that means that at a later stage we will have the vessel docked again to install the bow thrusters.
At 23 meters, the vessel's center of gravity is high. Extra flotation devices were needed to avoid it turning over during launch.
In a few days it will happen, and I hope it will go really good. But it will be really, really anxious moment. But we have looked at every aspect. A lot of calculations were made because of this very special vessel to launch. It's heavy, and the center of gravity is very high. So there'll be double check, and once more double check.
Dit rijtje, waar de kabel van breekt, moet de duiker het water in. Dan zet hij het kraantje open, komt hij er weer uit. Hij zegt dan, vind ik een boot hier en een boot hier die gewoon draaien, is geen probleem. Dus dat vindt hij goed. Ja.
On the 9th of October 2014, yard number 848 is successfully launched, witnessed by thousands of visitors and guests. Because of the narrow waterways in the north of Holland, vessels are typically launched sideways. School children were present to experience how important these traditions are for the region. Some of them may one day become the new generation of the shipbuilding industry. Specially designed and purpose-built, the walk-to-work vessel can now be completed. One key element still to be completed is the motion-compensated crane. The first ever crane on an offshore vessel able to operate in seas with wave heights up to 3 meters with such a small footprint on deck.
When we were investigating the concept of this vessel, we were looking for a motion-compensated crane, which was not in existence at this instance. So we stumbled upon Barge Master as delivering motion compensated cranes, but unfortunately too big for our application. But they were very willing to develop, especially for this project, a new crane and could do exactly what the client asked.
Yeah, it was about 2 years ago when Shell Nam came to us and they said, okay, we have a requirement, we would like to work from a floating vessel, put people on the platform and transfer goods to and from this platform from the floating vessel. And we know you'll have this large barge master, but we would like to have something which is more suitable for our needs. We decided to change the concept and go from large triangle with three cylinders to a small triangle, but with one internal cylinder for the heave compensation and two cylinders on the outside for the roll and pitch compensation.
After months of engineering and assembly, the world's first T40 crane is ready to be transported to the yard. On October 14th, she arrives by inland vessel.
Hello.
With the barge master in position, all key elements are ready to be thoroughly tested. The outfitting and commissioning can start. With all equipment and machinery for the key functions installed, the vessel must be tested to ensure that everything works in harmony and meets all specifications. This commissioning phase is essential before the vessel can be put into active service. After months of cutting steel and welding sections, the time has finally come for the vessel to leave the yard. Here, she isn't actually leaving the yard. She's only being transferred from the inner dike to the port location. Although it's a short journey, many obstacles have to be faced, such as the Delfzyl locks, where the vessel has only 7 centimeters clearance on each side. The ship will be docked for the installation of the Voith Schneider bow thrusters during Christmas time. These extremely low noise bow thrusters are of major importance for the dynamic positioning of the vessel. Basically, without dynamic positioning functionality, there could not be a walk-to-work vessel. Another crucial part is communication. 2 VSAT antennas are installed for fast internet access. And last but not least, the motion compensated gangway has to be installed. To ensure the safest and highest flexibility of offshore transfer possible, the Ampelmann must be centrally positioned. This way, the waves have the least impact on it. This vessel enables safe offshore transfers in waves up to 2.5 meters.
You could say that they did the normal job, because that's what they're supposed to do, build ships, but I really think that they put their hearts and soul into this project.
The work and the craftsmanship of these people, that's tremendous.
Sometimes it's underestimated what kind of quality we have in this region. These guys can compete with anybody in the world. I mean, it's often said, you know, they can build faster and cheaper vessels in the Far East, whether it's Korea or China. The combined expertise and knowledge and competency of these guys make this such a great product, so I think they can be very proud of themselves.
From the safety point of view, we'll be sailing with quite a lot of people who are not familiar with the vessel. And the muster station on this vessel is on the back deck. If an alarm goes, abandon ship alarm or fire alarm, everybody musters at the muster station.
On Thursday, the 9th of January 2015, the sea trials started. 3 weeks of intensive testing of the entire vessel and all her components. The vessel's speed, stability, maneuverability, equipment and safety features will be thoroughly tested.
Marcel de Boer.
Yes.
Men op beurt.
The only way to discover the vessel's capabilities is to exceed her limits. The crew needs to know what the ship is capable of and what her limitations are. This is one of the reasons for sea trials: exploring these limits and setting the controls. And testing the capabilities proved successful in stormy weather with gale force winds around 50 knots.
Up to now, we are very satisfied with the complete test program of 3 weeks. Of course, there are a couple of minor things which had to be resolved. The tuning of the dynamic positioning system took a little bit longer than expected. But in general, we are very satisfied in the smooth way things proved to be correct.
The Kroonborg is a key example of innovation, and I'm proud of what I see here around. I'm even more proud about thinking what it will do to the business.
When the client is satisfied, I'm satisfied. But I listen to the captain, and the captain is always honest. And I think I did hear him 3 days saying only, say, super, 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 all the time.
Although the Walk to Work project is a key example of innovation, the shipbuilding industry is very traditional.
One of the things is that when you invited someone for christening, you had to wear a beard. That's one. Second is that it's only allowed for ladies to do the christening. We have a very charming lady, and her name is Lydia Schotman.
I think it's great that my wife has been asked to be the christening lady for this vessel. She's proud, I'm proud. Ultimately, this is about innovation. It's something which we like. We have a strong agenda with the sea, and this is just a great honor to be a part of such a great story.
On Thursday, February 9th, 2015, the ship is christened in typical Dutch weather.
Ik doop u Kroonborg en wens u en uw bemanning een behouden vaart.
Respecting the shipbuilding tradition, yacht number 848 can now be called by her true name. The Kroonborg is ready for duty. She's leaving the port of Delfzijl on her first voyage to the Dutch offshore port of Den Helder. The port of Den Helder will be the Kroonborg's base, from which to start her autonomous 2-week scheduled trips in the southern part of the North Sea.
Yes, as you can see, it's one of the most sunny and windy ports in the Netherlands. If you see the map of the North Sea, where the offshore locations are located, this port has a very central position, and the distance to locations is quite optimal.
The North Sea is an environmentally sensitive area, so the vessel must be absolutely green. By using gas to liquid fuel, emissions are reduced significantly in comparison with traditional fuels. The Kroonborg is the first offshore vessel ever to use clean burning GTL. Berthed at the offshore port of Den Helder, Kroonborg is anxiously waiting for her crew, who are just arriving at the heliport.
Sending people offshore with a walk to work vessel, that's we think the future, because we're all looking at cost savings, and this could be an opportunity for the whole market to reduce cost. When people show up at the airport, we can see whether they have all the applicable training. If not, people are not allowed to go offshore.
For your information, I would like to introduce Hai Stichter. Well, actually, his father, the mother, the midwife of the Kroonborg. He gave us the concept from drawing board to what we see out there, and now Hai is supporting us on our first steps to become operational.
For us, it's fantastic to see that this complete package of aviation services, marine services, it all comes together in this project of the Kroonborg.
Finally, a new, most innovative milestone in Dutch offshore shipbuilding history is reached. The Kroonborg will start her operations. And then on the 2nd of April 2015, at 2000 hours, with hardly a sound and no vibration, the operation started for the very first time. This maiden trip for the Kroonborg will be the moment of truth. Will she really be that comfortable for the crew? Will she really make executing maintenance activities on the gas production platforms safer and more efficient?
Guys, just a couple of minutes of your time, please, just to give you a heads up of what we're going to be doing today. Today, we are at the Brigantine BG at 05:50 this morning. We were granted permission to enter the 500 metre zone. We'll then look to mobilise a team to man the platform with 6 POB. And then we'll transfer some scaffold boards over and create a landing area on the weather deck.
What we're going to do here is what we call a toolbox talk, is we'll talk through what we're going to be doing, make sure we understand what the task is, identify what the hazards are, and then from that we then identify what controls and mitigation we need to
do. Do you have 1 meter port side, please?
1 more port side, yeah, we can do.
Thank you.
After the briefing and toolbox meeting, the crew can finally walk to work. The first successful safe people transfer is a reality.
Historically, we've always visited these places, or most of them, by helicopter or by marine intervention, using small boats and climbing up the legs. But the Ampelmann takes us to a new place, I believe. It allows us to get to these places in a lot safer and secure manner. The bridge goes across and lands on the platform, but the hydraulics and the technology that allows it to sit motionless while the boat's listing about underneath us is quite remarkable.
Switch to temp, please, and then you can start with your crane. Ampelmann is finished.
Yeah, it's really an amazing piece of equipment. When you see it for the first time, you think like, however is this possible? And you get used to it, of course, like you always do in offshore. You know, it develops, you get to see something new, and then you get used to it. But it is an amazing piece of equipment, which will help us a lot in workability and operability in the maintenance field.
At 9 a.m., the daughter craft is launched. Daughter craft can be left behind at an offshore installation while the Kroonborg continues her trip to other platforms.
Yeah, Wilfried is outside. Wilfried.
The second rescue boat, a fast rescue craft, is launched to train an MOB, a man overboard situation.
FRC, Kroonborg Bridge, go ahead.
FRC in the water.
It's mandatory to have a rescue boat on standby.
Victim on board, please make your way back to the ship then. All stations, that's end of drill, end of drill.
The next training has just started, the frog escape training. The frog is intended for emergency situations only and will be put to use should the Ampelmann break down.
Okay, let's get out, guys. Questions about this? No, I don't think so. No? In that position, like that, yeah. Then the helmet is not...
If you look at the working and the collaboration between the marine crew of Wagenborg, of the operator, and one guest people, you see now, after already a few months of operation, that they are really trying to operate in a proper way together.
The crew is split really into three teams. However, we are all one team. We have the marine crew who operate the vessel. and we have the supervision shifts on board the vessel for NAM Shell. And then below those shifts, we have five execution teams which work together and mobilise on a daily basis to and from various NUI installations.
Exploring small gas fields and developing small gas fields in the North Sea is a significant task for NAM, and it's a task with a lot of potential. You have to be very innovative because the fields become smaller and smaller, and you have to find ways and means to continue to be cost effective. The Kroonborg is a good example of the innovation which helps us do that. And with these type of technologies and many other forms of innovation, we will be able to develop even smaller fields also into the future.
I know there's going to be some aspects that the project will have to overcome in the initial setup of the vessel for it to become standardised procedures, but overall I think they probably will be looking at getting more vessels.
Any project you have child's diseases, but I think I've told you before very early on in the project, I mean 3/4 of the functionality we needed and we wanted and we required was conceptual. There was no cold startup unit integrated in the vessel. There was no vessel that could carry the chemicals we needed to carry. There was no fully motion compensated crane available.
We've got a great opportunity here to really do something different and to make it happen. And I think everyone's got the same mindset. It's going to be a great success. I have no doubt on that.
It's state of the art. There's a lot of technology on this vessel that hasn't been deployed before on any marine vessel, or especially in the North Sea. Very, very impressed.
It's just such an interesting area that not a lot of people get to see. So when I go home and tell my friends what I've been doing, only a small percent of people in the world will be able to see these places. So it feels like, it's really exciting to be with one of them.
Hundreds of people were involved in a project resulting in an innovative vessel that the world has never seen before. Every single one of them, whether they managed, built, painted, outfitted, bunkered, slept, ate, or worked on it, is proud to be part of this project. NAM and Shell UK have made a huge step forward in their desire for a more efficient, comfortable, environment-friendly, and safe way of offshore work. Royal Wagenborg and Royal Niestern Sander demonstrated the capabilities of the Northern Dutch shipbuilding, maritime and offshore industries, and are proud to be major contributors to this project. A project characterized by many challenges, technical excellence, and innovative ideas, which could only succeed by working together closely. It's the attitude and spirit of all people involved that made Kroonborg possible.